is correct. I almost hesitate to even say something like this because my joke about the ship, this thing has to be shipped upside down from a wicked piece of the top to the middle bottom. It's just better say nothing. Any other questions? I have one question just came up. There's a, I said in the homework to calculate R so that the number of hits on the counter was between 160,000. That is the time to get to the threshold of 1.2 volts. So this time that you're actually measuring is going to determine the capacitance that has to be between 160,000 counts. What else? Well, at some point, that's what current is all about this. At some point, you try to find out enough current from all this to be simple belt. What is that current? It should be on the spreadsheet somewhere.
Output.
square wave, and let's say that's 1.2 volts, the square wave is going to look like that. So you could then take the cursors on your oscilloscope, freeze this, put a cursor right here, and measure the voltage on the grates. That would be the way to do it. Use a cell generator. So yes, the EDC does use a reference voltage, but not necessarily this reference voltage. It can use VDD. Now the question is, does this co-vary with VDD? And I don't believe so. I believe this is a band gap reference. So then you have to ask, which is more accurate, VDD or band gap? So how accurate is a typical voltage regulator? I actually put the part number of the voltage regulator on the lab write-up so you could look it up, although I hadn't intended that. And they're usually about 5%. Maybe a little better. So it's not clear whether you could do that or not, whether the ADC would give you an accurate enough reading. It depends on exactly how AREP is derived from DDD. Preemptive, it is cooperative which means that a thread has to explicitly yield to the threader. A thread that's executing must yield the CPU for the threader to take over. So there's one stack for all threads, so you have to be a little careful about variables. You can't define a variable on the stack for a thread because there isn't any stack for the thread. On the other hand, it's a very fast context switch. But because it is not a real-time operating system, because it is not a real-time kernel, you can't guarantee any sort of response time on any thread. Therefore, if you have a time-sensitive process, the time-sensitive means that it has to be microsecond accurate with low jitter, then, or anything less than a millisecond, really, anything less than a millisecond of time accuracy, you should use the interrupt service routine. Well, we're timing 200 milliseconds with the LCD. Do you care if there's a millisecond of jitter? No. I don't even think the most precise of you can detect a millisecond of jitter. Can anybody? There's usually one given to the can. People are not standardized. People have razor huge range of abilities in any parameter you can think of. So for lab one, I don't think you need anything better than a millisecond. I'm not going to no service routine at all. There is one running for you. On your behalf, there's a timer interrupt service routine running that maintains the millisecond counter that is used by proto threads to dispatch functions. Let's go back and look at this example. We were on the slide on last time. Oh, good. Yes, because I have to put the limb on. And I think last time we talked about the setting up the clock, the fact that the system frequency is running at 64 megahertz, which is a little hotter than the specified level, which is what run the CPU machines are required. We have to include PT_Cornell.h, because I need some extensions, which you can read about on the board. I want to start on this. Do you want to start with code and look at specifics, or do you want to start with a table of commands? Code using constraints and commands better than risk constraints and commands. We have to produce some control structures here. There's a set of structures called PTSM for semaphore. I'm going to define three semaphores, one to control thread one, one to control thread two, and one to control printing to the UART. The reason for doing this is that there's only one UART, and if two threads try to print at the same time, something bad will happen. Some buffers will be corrupted. So whenever you use the single communication port, you have to lock it with a semaphore. Then each thread that you're going to define, each different thread, has to have a structure. There are five threads that I've written in this example, all rather short and trivial, plus an input thread, an output thread, and a direct memory access output thread, which are part of the extensions I wrote for proto threads and not something you would write yourself. The advantage of using these is that when you ask for input from the terminal, which can take arbitrarily long, let's say that the user has gone out to lunch, they take arbitrarily long. If you use scanf, it freezes the system because this is non-preemptive operation.